everybody, this is Bedtime Bible Chat with Linda, and I have two guests tonight. Are we blessed or what? I have Pastor Patrick Winfrey as our special guest, and then we have Kari Brown as co-host, who's going to be representing the audience with questions that the audience might like to ask, but they aren't here to ask it, so Kari's going to do that for you. Now, Pastor Patrick, for those of you who don't know, he is a pastor, has been an ordained minister since 2001, and he has four orphanages out in the Philippines, and when he's over there, he takes care of the orphans, and he has a feeding program that feeds over 1,000 kids a week, including the orphanage too. So he's very busy over there, but right now he's here in the States because he's trying to wake up the bride of Christ. He has a YouTube channel, and that's what he's using to get through to the bride of Christ, that we need to be walking close to Jesus. Pastor Patrick, thank you for coming by.
Well, thank you for having me come by for your chat.
Oh, good. And Kari, thank you for helping us out tonight.
Oh, thanks so much for including me.
Oh, great. Now, Pastor Patrick is going to read Judges chapter 8, starting at verse 27, and we left off that last night. And then we're going to all discuss the lessons that we find in these verses. Okay, go ahead, Patrick.
All right. Judges chapter 8, starting at verse 27. And Gideon made an ephod thereof, and put it in his city, even into Ophrah. And all Israel went thither, and whoring after it, which thing became a snare unto Gideon and unto his house. Thus was Midian subdued before the children of Israel, so that they lifted up their heads no more. And the country was in quietness 40 years in the days of Gideon. And Jerubbaal, the son of Joash, went and dwelt in his own house. And Gideon had 70 sons of his body begotten, for he had many wives. And his concubine that was in Shechem, she also bare him a son, whose name he called Abimelech. And Gideon, the son of Joash, died in a golden old age, and was buried in the sepulcher of Joash his father in Ophrah of the Abizarites. And it came to pass, as soon as Gideon was dead, that the children of Israel turned again and went a-whoring after Baalim, and made Baal-Bareth their god. And the children of Israel remembered not the Lord their God, who had delivered them out of the hands of all their enemies on every side, neither showed their kindness to the house of Jerubbaal, namely Gideon, according to all the goodness which he had shown unto Israel.
Wow, you know, Kari, didn't you have a question about verse 27 that you said to me earlier?
Yes, I was asking about the word ephod, what it meant, and if I'm pronouncing it correctly.
Yeah, well, you know, now as far as the pronunciation, you know, unless you're a native Hebrew speaker, it's hard to pronounce it right. But as far as I know, the way that it's pronounced by theologians is ephod. And what it is, the ephod is what the priest would wear, the high priest. And in that was the stones, the 12 stones of each tribe of Israel he would wear on that thing. And what they were using it for in the time of Gideon, and like King David even made one. And a lot of people believe it's this thing called the Urim and Thurim. It's another thing that's mentioned in reference to King David to try to get a word from the Lord. So they're kind of they tried to use that ephod for divination, really, and that's what the text is talking about. People came there and began to worship this ephod he made, because Gideon was the man of God at that time, that it was somehow holy. And they begin to try to make an oracle out of it.
Isn't it funny how they just worshiped any old thing?
Yeah, yeah, it kind of reminds me of, I don't even want to go for it so quickly, but it kind of reminds me of the Catholic Church, you know, before they used to have the relics and all that. And, you know, in the time of Martin Luther, you know, he was a professor, at a university there in Germany, and that's how he got in trouble. He began to mock the fact that all these rich royal people of Europe, they were trading in relics, you know, like the bones of dead saints and all of these things, supposed to be a piece of the cross and all this, and kind of, you know, making it like a good luck charm. That's what they were doing in the time of Gideon too.
Yeah, and if you noticed, back whenever the Israelite kings or leaders had multiple wives and concubines and they had children by them, is it just me, or did a lot of them end up having children that came against Israel later and became an enemy of Israel? Is that right?
Right. Yeah, I think you're right. Could you repeat that? It was a little bit of trouble coming in on my end on that one.
If you notice that whenever the kings of Israel would have multiple wives and concubines and they had children by them, those children of the extra wives and the concubine usually ended up growing up to come against the Israelites.
That's right, just like Absalom, exactly. The son of King David.
Yeah,
it's true, and I mean that's the practical reason of, you know, because there's lots of religious people, and when I say that, I mean they love to be legalistic about, you know, and talking about like if you're divorced you can't be forgiven and all this kind of stuff. But you know the real reason everything that God made a sin, you know, that is a sin, is something that's actually a bad. I mean, it's bad for you and it's bad for everybody. As an example, divorce or having these concubines and all that, the reason why it's so bad is because of jealousy amongst, if you had two husbands or two wives, you know, in the Bible it's usually, you know, more than one wife. They're fighting amongst each other. They have, they're pitting their children against each other sometimes, mm-hmm. just like with King Solomon yeah. before and one of his other brothers. And that's where you get this rivalry. And just like, well, look at Abraham. Look at all the trouble we have now from the Ishmaelites.
That's right.
Of today. I mean, that's
where
Islam is.
Kari and I was discussing that they are still having that problem to this very day because of what happened way back when, you know?
That's right. Kari, that's right.
Kari, do you have any questions?
I was thinking about, you and I were talking earlier about when you get in these situations where you're tempted above what you can handle in regards to friends or who you surround yourself with. And I was wondering, in my experience, sometimes you try to remove yourself because you know that you're faltering, and then these friends, they come back and they say that you're not Christian because Jesus, you know, he frequented with sinners and that's what we were supposed to be doing.
All right, yeah, Patrick, what we were discussing was the part in there that was talking about how Satan seems to jump in when we're getting a victory, and we tend to forget about, you know, our righteousness for a while. We get all prideful and everything, and next thing you know, we're in the world and not in God. And she was asking about how, you know, say that again. I forgot.
About when you're involved with friends, maybe in my situation, friends that I've been with, friends with for 20 years before I was saved, and then I became saved, and the things that they're interested in or the things they want to discuss, it's sinful, so I try to remove myself, and I try to do it in a peaceful, polite way, but then they want to come back and say that that's not a true Christian way.
Right, yeah, that's the battle that we have with all the time, you know. Well, I will say this. Number one, you know, anything that would make us stumble or make us not be salt and light and make us get mad, and you know, and really kind of, you know, tell people off or whatever, even in a Christian way, is a situation we want to avoid, because, you know, we're not Jesus. So I'll say that first. You know, Jesus went among sinners all the time because he was Son of God, and of course he didn't sin, and he wasn't you know, he was able to be tempted in every way but without sin. But we, you know, we all have our limitations. As an example, let's just suppose that you're a man, and you decide that you're going to go to prostitutes and go to a house of prostitution and try to evangelize them. You know, it would not be advised for men to go and do that by themselves, you know. Yes. Or if you're a former alcoholic, to go in the bar and then try to evangelize people in the bar and you're a former alcoholic. You know, by yourself, without accountability, without people with you and things like that. So, you know, we can't just become, nobody's perfect. Even though Paul said he became all things to all people, you know, we have to, you know, we're not all the Apostle Paul, we're not all Jesus, and we have to just, you know, do as much as we can without inflicting harm or on ourselves or others, you know.
Yeah.
So we, you know, handle what we can handle, and that's it.
Well, see, that's right. That seems to be one of the problems the Israelites seem to have had. Every time their judges died, they went right back to the world. And I guess because they didn't have a judge to keep them on the straight and narrow, so they just went into the world and just started doing the pagan worshiping again. I mean, it's every it's just unbelievable how often they did that. You would think they would have learned their lesson.
Right. Well, you know, two things I would say about that. Number one is, you know, in the Old Testament, which, you know, we're in the New Covenant, the New Testament, not in the Old Testament.
Right.
Now, and a lot of people get that confused. That's probably one of the most topics I talk about all the time. But they did not have the Holy Spirit indwelling them the way we do. Only individuals like Gideon or Moses, the Holy Spirit came upon individuals. But because their sins weren't washed away by the blood of Christ, the Holy Spirit could not indwell them the way He does us.
I see.
So they weren't like Christians. The Bible says in Hebrews we have a better covenant. So they were looking to the physical. You know, when you think of Israel, it's the physical manifestation. They saw God. You know, as the Bible says, the Jews seek after signs because it's an outward appearance. And, you know, and then in Christianity we have the inward work, more of an inward work of the Lord. People getting saved, getting healed, and all that. But the second thing about that is too, just like in America, look at America today, you know, in the past, thank God, the Lord kept sending a new wave of His Spirit into the church, you know, but now in these last days, I mean, look at our culture, look how fast we went from a Christian nation, talk about Israel, because God has not been sending those revivals or moving in America like He did before. Look how fast America has fallen away. They forget about what God did before.
That's a great point. I never thought of it that way. And I never thought of the Israelites not having the Holy Ghost in them, and therefore it was so easy for them to go back into sin.
Right.
So that makes perfect sense to me. Did you have any questions, Kari?
I think you guys are covering it right now, I can think of. No, continue on, and I'll try to come up with some good ones for you.
Well, I was, Kari and I, while we were waiting on you, Pastor Patrick, we were going through my commentary on my Bible and familiarizing what they had to say. But you brought out some points that they didn't bring out, like the Holy Ghost indwelling in us, and they didn't have that back then. So that made it really understandable for me personally. It just goes to show that we have to constantly be on guard against Satan and the world. And with the world being as dark as it is right now, you know, we got to be even extra guarded. We have to really stay prayed up, repented up, and walk close to God right now, because the world gets darker every day, it seems.
Yeah, it is. Well, you know, that reminds me of you told me you, and I haven't listened to it yet, you did your interview with Doc Marquis. You know, Halloween's coming up this week.
And
that's a great example of and that's why I would just say to anybody listening to this, if you haven't heard Sister Linder's interview with Doc Marquis, he is a former Illuminati member, raised in that how many generations I forgot, but and then I'm gonna make a separate video and mention that also for this week, for this Halloween coming up.
Have you noticed that for decades I've noticed it, the week before Halloween, it seems like so much demonic possession takes place. So many weird things goes on the week before Halloween. And Doc said that the week of Halloween is when the druids do all of their Satan worship and their conjuring, and they're bringing up all these demonic beings. And so it makes sense why we're having such weird things going on, because tomorrow in the newsletter I'm going to have some weird things, news articles that I found today that just happened. And then yesterday I put it, it's just weird what goes on the week of Halloween.
It's crazy. I know, it's horrible.
But, you know, that's all the more reason for us to stay close to God, because the closer we get, the more protected we'll be. And these bedtime Bible chats are to mainly concentrating on the Old Testament, because don't get me wrong, I'm not Hebrew roots, and I'm not going back to the Old Testament under the law type thing. But my daughter made a statement one time that has never left me, and it was like I was supposed to keep that in my mind. And my light bulb came on the day I started doing these bedtime Bible chats, and that was when I was telling her something about the Old Testament. She says, "Oh, I'm a New Testament person." What? I'm a Bible person, the whole Bible, not just the New Testament. And that never left me. And so then I got to thinking, you know what? I've also heard other people say, well, you know, we are under the New Testament now, or we're under the New Covenant now. We don't have to pay attention to the Old Testament. That's just, you know, that's not relevant for today. And I knew better, and 'cause I studied under Chuck Missler, so I knew better. And I said, you know what, we need to bring that out and show that the Old Testament has lessons in them that is applicable for today. Sure, we're not under the law, but the lessons that are in each of these books are very relevant for today. Don't you think so, Patrick?
Absolutely. You know, well, Paul said that they're the King James says example, but it's example. You know, they're left as an example for us, you know, and we can learn about the nature of God. The problem, well, you mentioned the Hebrews Roots movement. There was somebody on YouTube that's just converted over to a sacred name, or as I call it, where you got to say the name in Hebrew or you're not saved. You got to say Yeshua. It's required. And there's a lot of that going on, and that's, you know, that's the caution I always have. Of course, you're not doing anything like that. But so, in other words, like what you said, we take the Old Testament as lessons, but we don't sit there and say, well, you know, Gideon went out there and made a jar of clay and then did this and that and the other, and so that's what I'm going to do. Right. I'm going to go make some lanterns, and, you know, and unless, you know, God may tell somebody to do that. But there are people who read these things and see it as something different.
That's,
you know,
right.
What I mean?
Yeah, I don't want anybody to misunderstand. I am not advocating Hebrew roots. I'm not advocating going back under the law. I'm just wanting them to see that the Old Testament is full of lessons for us to apply in our lives today. And so far, it has proven to be true, and my viewers are very, very blessed by me and my Bible commentary pointing out those lessons that even I never even considered, you know, because I didn't have my Bible commentary. This is a new Bible, and so now I've got the commentary to point out those lessons to me. And I thought, well, you know, this is something I ought to use to help other people see those lessons too. And then I got the idea to have preachers on here to help discuss it and give their take on what they think the lessons are too. And I've always loved the way you can dig out those lessons. You are like, I would have never thought about the fact that, you know, the Israelites weren't indwelled with the Holy Spirit, and that was part of the reason that they went back into sin all the time. That did never even mention, and my Bible commentary didn't mention it. So see, you always are able to bring it out, and that's what I love about your preaching.
Well, thank you, Sister Linda. But you know, yeah, I think what you're doing is great. Yeah, it's a shame. As you were talking, I was just thinking, it's a shame. You know, 99% of the people that you deal with are normal Christians. You know, it's always sad, and that's the downside of the internet and all that. You get somebody that comes on with some ideas that they think are new, which are really old ideas that's been going on. If you read your New Testament, you will see that the battle was over trying to put the church under the law.
That's right. Paul,
that's what it's talking
Paul
about.
Had a time and a half with the Jewish disciples wanting to go back to the law. You know, so we're still fighting that battle today with the Hebrew Roots movement and the like you said, those who want to go back to that Old Testament way of thinking. Just think of the lessons, but leave the rest behind.
Right, the letter of the law, as they say.
Yes.
You know, and the spirit, Paul said, get the spirit of the law gives life.
That's right.
And it's awesome. And so, yeah, I think the Old Testament, you know, I actually studied that when I started. The thing that when I first got started, it was, you know, I was like the Lord was showing me Christ in the Old Testament. You know, He is the Lamb of God.
That's right.
You know, the Passover Lamb and the temple represents Christ. And I even got a second, you know, really degree in Old Testament theology because I loved it so much. But like I say, it's a shame for me, because I, you know, when I try to do more teachings on it, there's always those, and I guess, you know, thank the Lord they're not bothering people too much, but you know, you always have those people that come and take it too extreme and try to bring in that we're under the law.
Yeah.
So that's you know, the biggest thing I would say to anybody listening to this, if you see people doing that, don't let them do that to you for sure. Go read Hebrews if you have any doubt about that, the book of Acts chapter 15. You can see that's all been put to rest, Galatians, and see that we are not under the law. So thank the Lord that we have Jesus who fulfilled all these things, you know. And can you imagine, like Gideon, all those things those guys went through was all pointing to Christ.
Amen.
And leading to Christ.
Well, you know, I've had Pharisees on my channel too, and they were, you can't listen to Linda because she's got short hair. Women are supposed to have long hair, and she's got short hair, so you can't listen to her. Oh, dear.
Yeah.
And she's a woman. You can't listen to her.
Right.
So on and so forth. So, yeah, you got the Pharisees everywhere. They're everywhere.
Yeah, they are. I tell you what. Well, you know what I said. I thank the Lord that, you know, the only reason why I ever even mentioned things like that is because, you know, they're out there trying to lead people to a different gospel.
That's right.
And, you know, and so we have to be very careful for the people, you know, that they won't let nobody draw them away from the grace they have in Christ.
That's right.
And so thank the Lord for that. And that's a thing about what happened with Gideon there. The people started going into that idolatry, and they started worshiping that ephod. And then, of course, like you mentioned about Gideon, he had all those concubines, and, of course, that made a lot of trouble. So he wasn't obeying what he should have been doing.
That's right.
And doing right. Well, it also shows, too, that even though someone's God, a servant of God, doesn't make them perfect. And,
that's right.
You know, and, you know, and there's lots of people, just like there's a lot of cults of personality of people that follow preachers, you know, and as if they're perfect. And then you got people that if someone's done anything wrong, you can't watch, you know, Billy Graham because he did this and that. You know what I mean? Which, you know, something that somebody, all preachers have made mistakes and sinned in their lives. So you got those people that cast stones because the preacher's not perfect, and other people that think that anything the preacher says, no matter what, is infallible.
Yeah.
You know, it's perfect, and that's not true either.
They can't seem to find a happy medium. Way I look at it is, if they've won souls to Christ, that's what's important.
Right.
And, you know, I don't want anybody to hold my sins against me, and they don't want anybody to hold their sins against them. So why are you, who are pointing fingers, holding somebody else's sins against them? Let God take care
right.
of that.
I guess they're trying to be a judge.
They're trying to be
like
God
judges.
Is what it is.
They want
Kari, did you have any questions?
Actually, I do. I was wondering if you're involved in a situation with a new seeker and you're trying to suggest where to begin in the Bible for them, what would be the best route for them to start?
Now, if they're going to actually start reading the Bible, you know, the thing about it is, I mean, I just say the short answer is I tell them to read John first because in a way it's simpler, but actually it's the most complicated on a spiritual level of the New Testament to me, of the Gospels. But, you know, the thing about it, when the Bible is spiritually discerned. And so that's why it's, when you're talking to someone, like you said, that's a seeker and they're looking for answers, you know, they can read the Bible. But, you know, when you also run into people who are trying to say, oh, I want to prove and show that the Bible is false. And, you know, they're looking, you know, and with wrong motives. Sometimes, you know, they can read the Bible. Of course, it's up to, you know, to the Spirit of God if it's going to have an effect on them, because they can't even understand
it. That's right.
You know, to them, it's like gibberish.
That's right.
If, yes. You know.
I try to explain that to them, because they'll ask me that. How did you understand? How do you know that this is the Word of God? How do you know that it hasn't been altered by the generations of people that have altered the Word? I get those questions a lot, and I don't always have a good answer, because I am young in Christ.
Right.
So I don't always know what to say.
Well, you know, the answer is, there's a guy who's written a lot of stuff, this guy Josh McDowell, but his stuff is like a college-level debates about stuff. But there's a guy that did these books, Lee Strobel. He's a lawyer who was atheist who tried to disprove the Bible, but he became a Christian. And he wrote a book called Case for Christ, Case for Faith, Case for the Creator. And he breaks it down like 10 main points. The thing about it, just to tell you, that we have copies of the Bible from about 200 or 250 A.D., complete copies of the Bible. And before that, we have the church fathers, they call them, the disciples of the disciples, like Polycarp is a famous one, Irenaeus. These guys wrote letters to each other. You know, before the Catholic Church came in and sent us into the Dark Ages by removing the Bible and changing the Word of God, every major city in the known world had a bishop, you know. So even John, before he died, he was a bishop of a city when he wrote Revelation and all that. So each of those bishops, the church fathers, they wrote letters to each other. And they would quote from what Jesus said, from the letters of Paul, from the letters of whoever, Peter. And so we have the complete Bible, except for about six verses. We have a complete copy of the Bible from the letters that the church fathers wrote in 150 A.D. They were already quoting from the Bible in letters to each other. And so, you know, we have those. And so as an example, in Islam, what are the things of Islam? They say, because Muhammad said in his writings that the Bible, the Christian gospels are true. But what the Muslims will say today, well, the gospels have been altered and Jesus didn't really die, and so it's wrong. But the problem is, we have copies of the Bible, thousands of copies of the Bible, before Muhammad was even born.
That's right.
So the copies that were around when he was alive is the same one we have today. So,
also,
you know.
The thing that helped me a lot with that question back when I was first starting to study real hard was Chuck Missler's videos, Learn the Bible in 24 Hours. They are 24 one-hour studies, and the first few videos blew my mind because he shows how it's impossible for our Bible to have been faked by man or to have been written by man, because the Holy Spirit put some codes in there, and he shows those codes on how the names of it. Now you might have to refresh my memory, Patrick, because you know I don't have a memory. I have to introduce myself to myself sometimes, but
you had to go look in the mirror to see who you are.
But all of the names of the is it the Old Testament fathers, they make a sentence, the meaning,
yes,
of their names,
right,
make a sentence. It,
that's exactly what it is. I just watched it.
Yes, it was just fantastic. fantastic. And he gives the chances scientifically of a human being able to do that and still be able to write a complete sentence where it's understandable. And it's just not possible. It's way, way beyond the possibility of man.